So now you have got a very young and energetic, knowledgeable person by name Dr. Akhilesh Kumar Singh. He is working in Sanchi as an Ayurvedic specialist. And he would like to share what the Acharya Vagbhatta. See, Vagbhatta in Ayurveda is something like a Davidson of modern medicine. So he wanted to share about what Vagbhatta is testing. I welcome Dr. Akhilesh Kumar Singh to make the presentation. Thank you.
Very, very thank you, sir. Honorable Chair, Professor Kumar, sir, and dear young friends. I am here just to share my views about Acharya Vagbhatta and Astanga Hridayam. It is my privilege to be a part of third international conference on Soa Rigpa. I will talk with you in three particular sections. As the topic given, Acharya Vagbhatta, this will be in the first section. I will talk on the Acharya Vagbhatta because knowing about the personality of Acharya Vagbhatta reveals a lot about his writings. So I will talk in the first section about Acharya Vagbhatta. In the second section, I will talk about the Astanga Hridayam. And in the third section, I will talk why Astanga Hridayam is a very peculiar treatise of Ayurveda. It has some edges over the Charak Samhita and Sushrut Samhita. So I will talk with you in these three particular sections. Just see, very basically, I would like to introduce Acharya Vagbhatta to you people. Acharya Vagbhatta is one of the principal contributors to the Ayurveda. He is famous for authoring the medical treatise Astanga Sangraha, which is known as Compendium of Medicine. And he has also authored the Astanga Hridayam, which is known as Heart of Medicine. Astanga Hridayam is written in poetic language. The peculiarity of Astanga Hridayam is it has been written in a poetic language, while Astanga Sangraha is a longer and prolix work of Acharya Vagbhatta. As per historians, if we place these two treatises in the timeline, we would find that the historians place the Astanga Sangraha in the first half of the 7th century, while Astanga Hridayam has been written in the later half of the 7th century. So Astanga Sangraha is the previous work of Acharya Vagbhatta in the later part of the 7th century. Astanga Hridayam has been composed in a poetic language by Acharya Vagbhatta. Acharya Vagbhatta is said to be the son of Singh Gupta, who was a Brahmin. His grandfather and son was also known by the same name, Vagbhatta. Here I want to emphasize, his father's name was also Vagbhatta, his name is Vagbhatta, and his son's name was also Vagbhatta. So there is a say in the history that Vagbhatta is not a particular person, but Vagbhatta is a name of a tradition who is going to compile the works that has been earlier done in the Ayurveda. All the three, the father, the son Vagbhatta, and the Vagbhatta himself, these three are the great Ayurvedic Acharyas. Vagbhatta was the disciple of Avalokit, and Avalokit was the chief monk of Mahayan Buddhism. So, Acharya Vagbhatta, by birth, was a Brahmin. However, he embraced Buddhism in the later part of the life, which we can find a glimpse of Buddhism in his writings as well. Vagbhatta describes about Astanga Hridayam in a verse that by churning the ocean of medical science, a great store of nectar by the name Astanga Sangraha was obtained. From the store of nectar has arisen Astanga Hridayam from the benefits of less intelligent people. It is very clear from this verse that Vagbhatta has taken the experts and materials from the pre-existing Ayurvedic treatise and has given it in another shape, that is the simpler word. Acharya Vagbhatta has cleared in his verse that whatever he has written in the Astanga Sangraha, whatever he has written in the Astanga Hridaya, is the simpler form of pre-existing Ayurvedic knowledge that was encodified in the Charak Samhita and Susrut Samhita. So Vagbhatta, what did? He has written the Ayurvedic knowledge that was in a complex form in the Charak Samhita and Susrut Samhita, in a simpler form, in a codified form, and in a practically utilizable form. So Astanga Sangraha, a little bit very prolix work, and Astanga Sangraha, more concise work and more in the simpler form. Vagbhatta simplified Astanga Sangraha and wrote Astanga Hridayam. Astanga Hridaya presented Ayurveda and its essence in a very simple and easy, comprehensive and understandable language. Astanga Hridayam comprises 6 sections, 120 chapters and 7120 easily understood Sanskrit verses. The total book has been divided in 6 sections, 120 chapters and total number of shlokas 7120. Now a little introduction about the Acharya Vagbhatta. In the history line, 4 Vagbhattas has been described. Vriddha Vagbhatta, which is also known as first Vagbhatta. Laghu Vagbhatta, which is described as Vagbhatta 2. Madhya Vagbhatta and Ras Vagbhatta. These 4 Vagbhatta has been described. Madhya Vagbhatta has been referred in Ratna Prabha commentary on Chakradat of Nishchalkar. And these 3 Vagbhatta are directly connected with the Ayurveda. Vagbhatta 1, which is Vriddha Vagbhatta, it is said that he composed the Astanga Sangraha, which was in the first half of the 7th century. Vagbhatta 2, which is also known as Laghu Vagbhatta, in the later part of 7th century, he has composed the Astanga Hridayam in the poetic language. And Ras Vagbhatta, he has written Ras Ratna Samuchya, which comprises a lot of Rasaushadhis in the Ayurveda. First time, the incorporation of metallic herbs, herbo-mineral preparations, that has been incorporated in the Ras Ratna Samuchya, and this is the exclusive contribution of Ras Vagbhatta. So, there exists a senile controversy regarding the identity of these personalities from time to time, and various scholars have worked to prove their individual views. So, summarizing the views about Vagbhatta, we can categorize these into the 3 groups. There are few historians believe that Vagbhatta 1 and 2, the 2 individuals are different. This is one set of people that believe, historians. Second set of people believe that Vagbhatta 1 and 2 are the same individual. And few people believe that Vagbhatta 1, 2 and 3, that is Ras Vagbhatta as well, was one and single individual. Though it is a controversy within the historians. The main proponents of the Ayurveda during ancient times are, you know, Acharya Susrut, one of the earliest surgeons, Acharya Charak, the medical genius, and Acharya Vagbhatta, who conceptualized the idea of compilation. So Vagbhatta is credited for first time incorporating the idea of compilation. So Vagbhatta was a compiler, however Charak and Susrut, he has written the original text, which was later on compiled in a simpler language by Acharya Vagbhatta. Together, Acharya Charak, Acharya Susrut and Acharya Vagbhatta, these 3 are termed as the trinity of Ayurveda. Vagbhatta coming later after the 2. As per modern scholarship, Vagbhatta was the ethnic Kashmiri. He belonged to the Kashmir region of India. And for instance, the German endologist Vogel said, judging by the fact that he expressly defines Andhra and Dravids as the name of two southern people or kingdom and repeatedly mentions Kashmirian term for particular plants, he is likely to have been a northerner and a native of Kashmir. However, Vagbhatta was born in Sindh, presently in the Pakistan, in a Hindu Brahmin family, but in the later part of his life, as I told, he embraced the Buddhism. Vagbhatta is famous for having presented Ayurveda and its essence in an easy, simple and comprehensive way. Astanga Sangra and Astanga Hridayam have glimpses of influence of Charak Samhita and Shushut Samhita. Astanga Hridayam is the easiest one among the two in terms of comprehensive understanding. The language used by Vagbhatta is worth appreciating. It is reachable to almost everyone who reads it, of course, with a good knowledge of Sanskrit. So, we can say that Vagbhatta was a Vedic, which is been proved by the explicit praise of Shiva by the name in the start of Astanga Sangra, and his praise for the Shiva under the title Unprecedented Teacher in the opening verse of Astanga Hridayam. This work contains syncretic elements. Although Astanga Sangra contains lot of references relating to Hinduism and Buddhism as well. This suggests that Vagbhatta was born in a Hindu Brahmin family and in the later part he adopted Buddhism. In the very late of his life, he went to Kerala just to explore few herbs. And Vagbhatta is said to be the founding force behind the tradition of Ashtavaidya, a very famous tradition of Kerala, the Ashtavaidya tradition. These are selected families of physicians in Kerala who are skilled practitioners of all the eight branches of Ayurveda. The term is derived from Astanga Vaidyan. Ast means eight and Ang means part. Kai, Bal, Graho, Urdhvang, Shalya, Drashtam, Jaram, Vrishay. These are the eight parts of the Ayurveda. Kai, Bal, Graha, Urdhvang, Shalya, Drashtam, Jaram, Vrishay. So, the concept of Astanga Vaidyam that has been flourished in the south part of the country, the credit goes to Acharya Vagbhatta. In Astanga Sangra, the name of the author was specifically mentioned as Vagbhatta. But in later commentaries of the Jajjat and Indu, the term used is Bahata in place of Vagbhatta. Bahat is the Prakrit variant name of term Vagbhatta. So there is no difference between Acharya Vagbhatta and Bahat. Later commentators use the term Bahat in place of Acharya Vagbhatta. Both the terms denote the same person, that is Vagbhatta. The author of a treatise Chikitsa Kalika, Acharya Tisatacharya, quotes that he is the son of Vagbhatta in the colophon at the end of the book. So Tisat was the son of Acharya Vagbhatta. On the other hand, Chandrat, the son of Tisat, wrote the commentary on the Chikitsa Kalika but has not mentioned the name of Vagbhatta in his book. So a little bit of controversy emerges in the historians, and I have placed all the facts before you regarding to Acharya Vagbhatta. Based on the various evidences, present-day scholars clarify the period of Tisat and Chandrat to be in the 10th and 11th century. Hence, it is difficult to believe, in fact, impossible to believe that Tisat was the son of Chandrat and was the grandson of Vagbhatta. So these are the different opinions between the historians. Now let us talk on the Astanga Hridayam a little bit. Astanga Hridayam, also known as the epitome of Ayurveda. This is the quintessence of eight branches of Ayurveda. You know, Acharya Charak has written the Charak Samhita, which is basically a text of medicine, primarily a text of medicine. And Shushut is said to be the primarily a text of surgery. But this is the quintessence of all the eight branches. Kai, Bal, Graho, Urdhvang, Shalya, Drashtam, Jaram, Vrishay. So, Acharya Vagbhatta has given due importance to all the eight branches, equal importance to all the eight branches, rather giving more importance to the Kaya Chikitsa or more importance to the Shalya. However, he is said to be the scholar of the school of medicine. So, somewhere medicine dominates in his writing, but he has given equal importance to the other branches beyond the Kaya Chikitsa. Other seven branches has been given due recognition and due place in his writings. So, first credit of the Astanga Hridayam is it has given importance to the all eight branches of the Ayurveda. It has attracted the attention of medical fraternity not only within India but also of the neighboring country such as Arabia, Persia, Tibet and Germany. It is popularly substantiated by a large number of commentaries by Indian scholars and appreciation by the scholars of many other countries. You know, Astanga Hridayam is the only text on which maximum number of commentaries has been written. Total 33 commentaries has been reported to be written on the Astanga Hridayam. This only signifies the importance of this Astanga Sangra because it has given place to the all sections of the medical needs that has been described very elaborately in a very simple and understandable way. With its beauty and brevity of poetical composition, of percepts and practices of the medical science and many other merits, it has earned the rightful place as one among the Brihatrayi. Three basic texts of the Ayurveda, Charak Samhita, Shushru Samhita and this Vagbhatta, these three are known as Brihatrayi, three basic Brihatrayi texts of the Ayurveda. Because of this importance, this particular text has achieved a place among the Brihatrayi, which is Charak, Shushrut and this Astanga Hridayam. It is really an epitome of Ayurveda, catering the needs of the students, scholars and medical practitioners alike. Astanga Hridayam presented Ayurveda and its essence in a simpler way. At the beginning of the treatise, the author states, he is going to describe only such information as has been revealed by the sages like Atreya. Because this is the Atreya Parampara. Atreya Punarvasu, he has written, he is going to compile, he has very in the initial verses, he has clarified that he is going to compile whatever has been existing in the present knowledge, he is just going to compile the things. These statements vouchsafe the authenticity and reliability of the information contained in the text. Astanga Hridayam comprises, as I told, six sections, 120 chapters and this. The author quotes Charak, Shushrut, Bhel, Nimi, Kashyap, Dhanvantri and other earlier authors and their works. The chief source, however, is the Astanga Sangra. Astanga Hridayam seems to emphasize on the physiological aspect of the body rather than the spiritual aspect of it, like its counterpart, Charak and Shushrut. So he has emphasized much more on the physiological aspect rather on the spiritual aspect. Astanga Hridayam is considered as a combined form of both Atreya and Dhanvantri schools. Astanga Hridayam mainly focusing on the Kaya Chikitsa. Astanga Hridayam is also discussed in detail about the various surgical procedure. So he kept always a balance between the surgical procedures and the medicinal treatment. Many of the Ayurvedic medicines are prepared through the methods described in the Astanga Sangra and Astanga Hridayam. The cough subtype are first listed and described in this particular Samhita with exhaustive explanation of Vata, Pitta and cough along with the five subtypes. So, Vagbhatta cannot be said that he was an exclusive compiler. At various instances, he has contributed Ayurveda by giving some new concepts. Like, for the first time, in a very detailed elaboration, he has described the cough and the subtypes of Vata Pitta cough. So, the types of cough and detailed elaboration of cough is the exclusive contribution of Acharya Vagbhatta. The Vata exclusively described by the Charak and Pitta by the Shushrut and Kapha by Acharya Vagbhatta. So this is the basic contribution along with the compilation that has been done by Acharya Vagbhatta. Now let us see a glimpse of the total text of Astanga Hridayam. As I described, the six asthanas are there. The first one is Sutra Asthana. The first section has 30 chapters dealing with the basic doctrine of Ayurvedic principles of health, prevention of disease, properties of articles of diet and drugs, humoral physiology and pathology, different kind of diseases and methods of treatment. You know, this particular section codifies in a very short the very basic principles of health and what are the factors which are the first departure from the health. Just see the basic contribution of Acharya Vagbhatta here. In the Sutra Sthan, Acharya Vagbhatta very specifically mentions the health, the status of health and departure from the health. You know, what is the difference between the disease and departure from the health? Disease is a sequence of events that has been led, and after this sequence of events, a lot of things has been happened, and then they are cumulatively called as disease. The first departure from normalcy leading towards the disease has been described by Acharya Vagbhatta in this Sutra Sthan. Not only this, the prevention promotion of the health has also been defined in this Sutra Sthan by the Dincharya, the Ritucharya, the Achar Rasayan. All these things has been described by Acharya Vagbhatta, how to preserve, prevent and upgrade the health. You know, the concept of preservation of health, promotion of health is going on. But now the talk is going on the platform for the upgradation of health. I believe and I think everybody is healthy who is sitting in this hall. However, with each seasonal variation, somebody gets the cough and cold and sneezing and all the things. Such kind of health needs to be upgraded. Needs to be upgraded from the climatic shield. These things has been very elaborately described by Acharya Vagbhatta in his Sutra Sthan. I will finish in a quick run. So, Sharira Sthan, you know, dealing the concepts about the embryology, anatomy, physiology. So, these things has been in the Sharira Sthan and in the Nidan, the methods of the diagnosis of a disease, pathogenesis and prognosis has been mentioned in the Nidan Sthan. In the Chikitsa Sthan, as you know, the treatment modalities, Shaman and Shodhan Chikitsa has been described here in the Chikitsa Sthan. Kalp and Siddhi, it is very important, where Kalp, Kalpana Asthan, different treatment ways has been described, and Siddhi, how to disease been cured and how you can get the Siddhi, this has been elaborately described in the Kalp and Siddhi Asthan. And in the Uttar, a lot of description like the Urdhvang, ear, nose, throat and all the different streams, Netra Rog, Mukh Chikitsa, and all the Shalya, Dastram, Jaram and Vajikaran, all has been described in the Uttar Tantra. So, quitting few slides, I will come directly to the peculiarity. I would like to talk over some of the peculiarity of Ayurveda, of this particular medicine. 2 to 3 more contributions I would like to share. First time in the history of Ayurveda, the use of vishas, toxins, in medicine has been contributed by Charak. This is one of the major contributions of Acharya Vagbhatta, which we do remember. The ahifen, chun, for the first time, asphatodia, has been incorporated by Acharya Vagbhatta. So use of toxins, just to purify the toxins, vish, upvish, and use it for the medicated purpose. This is another contribution of Acharya Vagbhatta. The concept of Shat Kriya Kal, Chay Prakop Saman, This was very elaborately been contributed by Acharya Vagbhatta. So I have a little bit less time, so I will conclude. So Vagbhatta, with the tradition, by the questioning the concepts and ideas behind kapha, pitta and vayu, he emphasized the importance of personal hygiene to good health, to introduce the importance of combating pollution. Acharya Vagbhatta has emphasized the idea that vata, pitta, kapha only not these three tripods are the cause of the disease, but he has also introduced the concept of the personal hygiene, combating pollution by elaborating the role of contaminated river water in adversely affected health. He prepared numerous antidotes and worked on their formulae, some of which are used today. So these are the major contributions by Acharya Vagbhatta. So thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Akhilesh, for your lecture enlightening us about the versatility of Vagbhatta. And another important thing you have said, he traveled from Kashmir to Kanyakumari.
Yeah.
So that he might have percolated the knowledge, at the same time he might have taken the knowledge also. It's a good thing you have enlightened us. So a few more, two persons can ask some clarifications from Dr. Akhilesh Kumar.
Are you familiar with the Tibetan, the role of Vagbhatta and Astanga Hridayam within Tibetan medicine? I mean, for example, there's a slightly different biographical connotations, and as well as various other commentaries that don't exist in Sanskrit that are preserved in Tibetan. Have you done much study into this or anything?
No. Since last 1 or 2 years, I'm working the healing modality that was available in the time of Buddha. Like, you know, Jivak, Vagbhatta, and these all are the Buddhist monks, and they have contributed a lot. You know, one more fact I just want to share with you people. A very historical fact, a controversial fact, but just I want to share a few things. You know, there is a lot of influence of the Buddhism on the Ayurveda, and actually Buddhism has contributed to the Ayurveda a lot. But unfortunately, Ayurvedic historians has not given due importance to the contribution that was given by the Buddhism to the Ayurveda. Buddhism, the Buddhist monks, just not only like this Vagbhatta, he has later embraced the Buddhism, and whatever the contribution he has given, the credit goes to the Buddhism, because Avalokit was his guru and he was a Mahayana saint. So you know what happened in the Ashoka period. Actually, Ashoka banned the bloodshed in his kingdom, and he was so cynic for this that he has also banned all the surgeries. And you know, Ayurveda was well known for his surgery, and Ayurveda was primarily known for the surgery. But unfortunately, in the time of Buddhist era, in the Ashoka period, when he banned the bloodshed in his Buddhism, in his era, all the surgeries has been demolished. And you know, the connection of the surgery has been delinked, because at that time most of the tradition was oral tradition from guru to shishya and from guru to shishya. So the tradition broke, and Ayurveda discredited this emperor Ashoka for the demolition of his Ayurvedic surgery. Probably, I think this was the reason why Ayurvedic historians doesn't hesitate to give credit to the Buddhism for the contribution. But you know, Emperor Ashoka has also asked his Vaidyas to evolve such a system which can replace the surgery. And in that particular era, you know, this Ras Shastra has been evolved, and all the quick acting medicines, which was the herbo mineral preparation and mineral preparations, that was also evolved. So Ashoka has tried just to replace the surgery from such a modality that may heal us without invasion, without invasive therapy. So the credit goes to the Ashoka as well for the development and for the evolution of this metallic preparations and these all preparations. But at that, so there is a strong connection, that what you asked and you want to know. There is a strong connection and very, very vital contribution of Buddhism to the Ayurveda. But this text was for the first time has been translated probably in the Tibet language, as well as in the other countries, like I have mentioned, in the Persia and other countries. So this text was first to migrate from this particular continent to the other continent, and A lot of work has been done in the other countries, which influence for the development of Tibetan system of medicine as well, what we know. And since last 1 or 2 years, I am working a little bit on these, the healing practices that was preponderance in the time of Buddhism and later on in the periods of Buddhist emperors.
Thank you so much, sir, for your informative lecture. So I would like to know that when Astanga Hridayam, they talk about the Oj or Par Oj, as a comparative study to the modern study, modern medicine, what do you explain? How do you explain Oj in modern medicine, sir?
Very good question. Just see, these type of questions are being frequently asked. What my personal view is, just before the session, we are talking about this. Just see the way of Ayurvedic. Ayurvedic philosophy depends on Vata Pitta Kapha. We need not to explore these philosophies along with the modern philosophies. You know, the Vata Pitta Kapha, these are the philosophical fundamental principles that Ayurvedic people has. And over these fundamental principles, all the doctrine of Ayurveda has been dependent. If we compare this Vata Pitta Kapha from wind, humor, like this, just the concept of Ayurveda destroys here. We have a concept of Par Oj and Upper Oj. If we correlate this particular thing from the immunity, you are shrinking the concept. We have a disease Pandu. If we compare it from the nutritional deficiency anemia, you have killed the concept of Pandu. Pandu has a, you know, Charak Samhita, only 30 chapters of Chikitsa Asthan. All the diseases that are prevalent in now, in present era, has been incorporated in the 30 chapters. We have first chapter of Jwar Adhyay. All the Dhatugat Jwaras have a different signs and symptoms. So I humbly request you not to compare the Suvaripa fundamental principles, Ayurvedic fundamental principles with the modern principles. Modern principles have their own philosophy of working. If you are going to compare the Suvarigpa fundamental principles with the modern principles, you are doing injustice with your practice. And I am coming from such a school that my teachers have taught that istik, we need to diagnose our disease. If we need to diagnose the pandi, you need to diagnose from the nadi, from the jiva, from the mal, from the mutra, not from the blood test. If he is anemic, you are saying just hemoglobin is 6, he is the patient of Pandu, and you are writing. You are diagnosing the patient from the modern way and you are treating the patient from the Ayurvedic or Suvarigpa way. This is the basic reason why we are lacking. So this is my humble request after a long practice not to compare. Never, you need not to compare your pathy with the other. They have their own philosophy of working. You have your own philosophy of working. You have your fundamental principles, which is a hypothetical principle. Have you seen Vata? Have you seen Pitta? Have you seen Kapha? This is the sputum is not the Kapha. If you shrink this particular concept, so this is the basic reason why we are lacking. So this is my humble submission, not to compare these two principles. Diagnose from your own pathy, treat from your own pathy, not diagnose from the modern tools and techniques and treatment devices. Diagnostic tool you are utilizing is modern and treatment given is Ayurvedic or Suvarigpa. So this is not the honesty with the pathy. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Akhilesh. So anything you want to clarify, you have got his email ID, so you can write to him. He will be so happy to clarify all these things. Yeah. So once again, with the thanks to the audience also, I conclude this session.
Thank you.